Welcome to another hands-on lesson. In this one, we're going to deploy and scale an Amazon Elastic Kubernetes Service cluster. Now, word of warning, this one can take a little bit of time. Some of the processes for deploying the cluster can be quite time-consuming, so you've got to be prepared to wait a little bit. And there may be a little bit of money involved, maybe a couple of dollars, shouldn't be much more than that, especially if you delete your cluster after you've finished playing around with it. In the course download, you will find in the code directory and then Amazon EKS, you've got this deploying and scaling an Amazon EKS cluster.md file. So what we're going to do, we're going to create a cluster and you're going to see how we can then scale the cluster using the horizontal pod autoscaler. Now we're going to be doing a lot of this on the command line, so we're going to use AWS CloudShell. First thing we need to do is make sure we've got the AWS CLI. So either you can do that on your own command line on your computer, or you can use, as I suggested, AWS CloudShell. And then the first thing to do after that is to install kubectl. Okay, so what we can do is copy this entire curl command here. That's the entire line, line 12. Let's open up AWS CloudShell, and I'm simply going to paste in that entire command. That completes very quickly, and the binaries have been downloaded. The next thing to do is to run this sudo install. So we're going to copy the entire line 14. That will install the kubectl utility. Next, we need to install the eksctl command line tool. Now to do that, what we need to do is create a script called eksctl, and the contents of that script are going to be the code from line 21 through to 32. Okay, so first off, let's create a file. I'm simply going to use nano to create the file. Now I can copy all of this code. You don't really need the comment line at the top, so maybe I'll start at line 22 across to 32. Paste that in, confirm that I want to paste it, and then I'm simply going to save my file. So now I've got that file ready to go. Okay, that's my script. We need to make sure the script is executable, so we run chmod plus x and then the script name, and then we should now be able to simply run sudo sh to run this shell script. So let's run our script, and that's completed with a little OK response there. Okay, next we're going to use eksctl to create a new Amazon EKS cluster. So you can see the command here, it's eksctl create cluster. The name is my EKS cluster. Region is US East 1. We have a node group name. We have the node type, which is T2 small. We're going to have three nodes, and there can be a minimum of one and a maximum of five. So let's copy all of this code. This is the entire line 42. I'll just clear my screen. Let's paste this in and run this. Now, as you can see, it's saying that it's going to deploy a stack. So if we go across to AWS CloudFormation, we should see that a stack is being created, and this can take a little while to complete. So here is the create in progress. Let's click on the stack name, go across to events, and now we can keep an eye on what's being created. It's been about 15 minutes at this point in time. The first stack that was created by the cluster deployment has completed, and we can see the various different components. Quite a lot was created there, including a VPC, NAT gateways, IAM roles, and various other resources as well, as we can see here. So now the actual cluster has been created. So in Amazon EKS, we can see our cluster. But as you may have noted, another stack is now in creation. So we've got to wait a little bit longer. Now we can see it's creating the node group. Back in CloudShell, we can see this is continuing. So we are at the next stage of the deployment. Okay, we now have a create complete for both of those stacks. You can see the various resources that have been created. So we have our node group, our node instance role, launch template, and so on. So our cluster is now ready. Now let's go over and have a look into EC2 just to see what we see there. Okay, so here we have some instances running. This is our node group. These are our three nodes. We can also see that at this point in time, we don't have a load balancer. That's going to come soon. But we have the instances. There are some Elastic IPs, or there's one Elastic IP here that appears to be associated with the NAT gateway. So a few resources have been created. You can look at the cluster as well and have a look at the information in the resources here. We've got the pods. You can see what's in there, replica sets, deployments. We've got compute here as well, so you can have a look at the free nodes that have been launched. Okay, so what's next? We want to get an application running. So now we're going to move on to step three here. We're going to deploy a sample application, which is going to be an Nginx web server. So what we want to do is create this file called deployment.yaml. So I'm going to run, let me just clear the screen for you, nano and then deployment.yaml, or use your favorite text editor. And then I'm going to simply copy all of this YAML code from line 52 to line 70. I'm going to paste that in, confirm, and then simply save the file. Now it's just a case of deploying the sample application to our cluster. So we're going to run this kubectl, where we're going to apply the deployment.yaml file. So again, we just run that command, and it says the deployment has been created. We next want to expose the application using a Kubernetes service. And the way we do that is we run this kubectl expose deployment, Nginx deployment is the name, and then the type is load balancer, and the name is my service. So simply copy all of the code from line 84. Let's paste that in. And that's run, and now it says service is being exposed. Next, let's get the external IP address of the load balancer so we can run this kubectl command. Run that at the command line, and we can see that we have a service, type is load balancer, we've got the cluster IP, and then the external DNS here. It says external IP, but obviously it's actually a DNS name. Now let's go across to EC2 and see what has been created. So I'm going to refresh under load balancers, and now we have this load balancer here. So let's try copying that DNS name, which presumably should match what we see here. And indeed it does. And then let's paste this in. And we're not seeing anything yet, so let's come back and just check that this is set up correctly. Now this, by the way, is a classic load balancer, so we can't even see it in this particular window. This is one of the older styles of load balancer, which is still used by these Kubernetes services. So here we can see a bit more information on the load balancer. Let's check the security group to make sure that it has the relevant ports open. So this is the particular security group here, and it should allow HTTP 80 from any source. Okay, so that looks okay. So maybe it's just a matter of time. There we go. It certainly was. It just took a bit of time to have this service running. And now we get the welcome to Nginx. So now we've deployed an application, and then we've exposed it using a service. The next thing I want to show you is how we can set up the horizontal pod autoscaler. So this then allows scaling the cluster automatically based on CPU utilization, and it's about scaling the pods. So we're going to create this file called hpa.yaml. So again, I'm going to use nano. You can use any text editor. And then let's put in this YAML code. Paste that in, confirm, and then we're going to save the file. And we now have this kubectl apply command. So let's apply this configuration. And that's it. We've created that configuration, we've applied it, and now it's going to scale the cluster automatically based on CPU utilization. So those are the main activities for this particular lesson. I would encourage you that while you now have this cluster running, have a look around, familiarize yourself with the console and the configuration of the EKS cluster. EKS is quite a complex, or Kubernetes, I should say, is quite a complex service. And so a lot of different components here, which are all being managed for you by AWS. So even though this is a little bit more involved than creating an ECS cluster, it's also a hell of a lot easier than creating an EKS cluster or a Kubernetes cluster independently of AWS. Now, in some cases, you may find that some of the resources are not actually visible to you. So pretty much looks all good to me. If that's the case, if you come in here and you can't see some of these resources, it may be that you need to configure permissions for your IAM user account. So here's what we need to do in that circumstance. We're going to run this command from line 125. So let's go back to CloudShell, run the command, and it's going to output this AWS auth.yaml file. So let's have a look at that file. I'll just use the cat utility. And here is the file. Okay, so we need to make a couple of updates to this file. And the way it should end up looking is like this one here, but we need to add some entries to it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy all of this code here. So basically the contents of that file. And then I'm going to paste that in. Okay, so now it looks kind of similar, but I need to add in the bits that are missing. So we have this map roles, and what's really missing here is the map users piece. So let's copy this map users, and that's going to go in underneath this section here. So it should look like this. And then the rest should be the same. Okay, so now it's just essentially we've just populated the information, including our account number. All right, so let's just delete this stuff above it so that we clean this up so we know what we're dealing with. What we need to add in now is our user ARN and our username. Well, my username is simple. That's Neil. Now let's go and get my user ARN. So let's head over to IAM, and I'm going to find my user account and then copy my ARN. And let's paste that in here. Now we have the contents for our file. Nothing else needs to change, so I'm just going to copy that code. I'm going to delete the AWS auth.yaml. I'm going to create a new version of the file and then paste in my code, confirm, and then simply save the file. Then we can just run this command to apply this configuration file. So despite the warning on there, that should now have made the required changes. So if you do find that you don't have permissions to view items in the EKS cluster, that is the way to go to fix that issue. And that's basically it. We've now created our cluster, we've configured our permissions, we have launched an application and then exposed it using a service and a load balancer. So once you have finished familiarizing yourself with EKS, don't forget to go ahead and delete your service and cluster. Of course, it does take quite a few minutes for the CloudFormation stack to unwind the various resources, but just do these in order. So first, delete the service, then delete the cluster.